I am happy to welcome everyone here to this after lunch session. And my name is Rebecca Ghost, and I am the host of this wonderful session. And I'm Associate Professor of Dance at the University of Georgia. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Katherine Cotter here for an engaging talk today on the arts and flourishing. I'd like to talk a little bit about her, just mention a brief bit about her. Dr. Cotter's Associate Professor of Research with the Humanities and Human Flourishing Project at the University of Pennsylvania. And in her work, she focuses on connections between engagement with creativity in the arts and flourishing, which I'm sure we'll really hear a lot about today. Katherine received her PhD in psychology in 2020 from the University of North Carolina at Greensboro, and currently much of her work is focused on how visual art and visiting art museums can improve emotional well-being and help people thrive in their lives. And today she'll be presenting specifically on research, examining the multitude of ways in which arts engagement can enhance our human flourishing. And we have a presentation for about 45 minutes. And then please, we invite you to post your questions in the chat as the directions say there, or use the raise hand function to ask a question. All right, so without further ado, take it away, Katherine. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you so much for introducing me and for the invitation to present in this wonderful platform. Very excited to share some of the work that I've been doing around arts engagement and how it can help us to live a flourishing life. And so if we think about artistic engagement, it is incredibly common. In recent years, in the United States, millions of adults have attended arts events such as visiting art museums, attending a concert, taking part in a craft fair, having their own personal artistic hobby. In 2017 alone, over 130 million adults in the US took part in these types of activities, and globally we see similar levels of high engagement. So there are high levels of engagement with the arts in the United Kingdom, Finland, Sweden, Norway, and Poland. And although less research has been conducted in non-Western and non-global North nations on these topics, historical and anthropological works have documented rich cultural traditions within these nations, suggesting that the arts play an important role in societies across the world. But most large-scale population-level studies of art engagement, such as the ones I'm referencing here, typically emphasize formal types of art engagement, particularly engagement with cultural institutions, such as art museums, concert halls, or professional theaters. But the arts aren't only found in these types of institutions. To fully understand the depth of arts engagement, we must consider the activities people engage in during their day-to-day lives as well. And so this was the aim of a recent study of a representative sample of 900 United States adults. And in this survey, we asked people to identify an arts-related activity that they regularly engage in, which people were very readily and easily able to do, further underscoring the frequency with which people engage in the arts in their day-to-day lives. And these activities were predominantly in the domains of music and the visual arts, mirroring findings from other research, finding more frequent attendance at music and visual art events. But we also asked people to rate the qualities of this type of arts engagement, as well as for a non-art related activity that they regularly engage in, such as watching sports or playing sports, for example. And in those ratings, the arts activities were viewed more positively than non-arts activities, were rated as more influential in changing their perspectives, and providing more opportunities for reflection, retrospection than non-arts activities. People also found the arts activities to be deeply immersive, allowing their attention to be absorbed in the activity and the experience of flow occurring during these artistic engagement. They were also seen as a way to express themselves, which is further underscoring the relationship between arts engagement and our creative processes, particularly in some of these everyday artistic activities. And so existing research reaffirms the notion that the arts are a near constant force in our lives. We spend our leisure time engaging with cultural institutions, or perhaps engage our own creativity to dabble in the arts ourselves. The arts are used as communication tools, shape societal conversations, and hold the potential to change lives. But if we imagine for a moment what our lives would look like without art, without music or our favorite songs, without dance, without theater or film and television or even literature, for many people, our life would lose much of its vibrancy. As you consider this scenario, you may be thinking about never watching your favorite movie again, no longer having your painting hobby, or if you're like me, how you'll possibly do any work without your favorite playlist on Spotify, helping keep you motivated as me to write yet again another paper. And so with the multiple and diverse roles the arts play in our lives, it's very important to understand how people are engaging with these different fields and how this type of engagement with the arts impacts us. And so this is the purview of an emerging field called the positive humanities, which is a new field of inquiry and practice concerned with the relationship between culture and human flourishing. So understanding the ways in which our artistic and cultural engagement impacts our flourishing. And now, before I go too far into my presentation, it's probably helpful for me to explain why I'm using this term human flourishing and what exactly I mean by it. And so when you enter the domain of well-being, of health, disease, thriving, there are a lot of different terms that get thrown around and not necessarily the most consistent fashion. So for the purpose of my presentation here, and in my work more broadly, I'll just explain the types of terminology that I tend to use and how I tend to use them. And so I use the term human flourishing or flourishing, which you'll hear several times throughout the talk today, to refer to kind of a wide variety of things, kind of as an umbrella term, capturing what it means to live a good life. Within this broad category of flourishing, we can think about two main components, the first being well-being. And here by well-being, I'm referring to positive states, traits, or experiences. So this might be having a positive emotion or feeling happy, being satisfied with our life, having an experience that gives us meaning or helps us clarify what our goals are, for example. And when we think about well-being, these are things that we want to promote or increase in our lives, or if we already possess them, to maintain them at high levels. So to flourish, we're generally talking about having high levels of well-being. On the flip side, with well-being, this often has fallen under the purview, at least in modern research, under the purview of positive psychology largely. And so I come from the Positive Psychology Center at the University of Pennsylvania. And so that's where a lot of my work has emphasized in particular. But on the other hand, we also have ill-being, which are negative states, traits, or experiences. So feeling negative emotion, having stress in our lives, feeling burned out in our work, having fights with our loved ones, and so forth. And so in general, we seek to prevent these states of ill-being from occurring or to mitigate them if they're present in our lives. So we may go to a doctor to treat our broken ankle. So we're trying to mitigate and eventually get rid of that particular state of ill-being. And so when we're talking about flourishing, we're talking about lower levels of ill-being and higher levels of well-being. So I'll be using these three terms throughout the presentation, and this is just a little bit of a roadmap about how I'm using them and what I'm using them to refer to. And so as Rebecca mentioned in her lovely introduction, my current work has focused around art museums and flourishing. And this has really become a booming area of scholarship, both from psychologists like myself, but also from individuals working in the cultural sector, trying to understand what their institutions are impacting and trying to design programs to try to cultivate flourishing in their visitors. And in a scoping review of what's already been done, because I couldn't do research during the pandemic, so I was like, what has everybody else done? Let's do a review. And found that a lot of work has focused really on people's emotional experiences. And so we see that people who are going to the art museum after their visit, during their visit, feel greater positive emotions. So we're cultivating that aspect of well-being through art museum visits. They're also feeling greater levels of engagement, not only during their visit, but in their lives more broadly. There are potential implications for people's mental health, so this area of ill-being, through reducing people's stress levels or feelings of anxiety through these visits. Consistent visitation of the lifespan has been associated with living longer, lower risk of developing dementia and some other psychological disorders. And so there are mental health implications for what it means to take care of your mental health and self-care. Art museums are one potential outlet for taking care of these things yourself or trying to address some of these symptoms yourself. We also see subjectively people feel better through their art museum visits. So they feel subjectively that their well-being improves. They feel greater quality of life. And a lot of work has really focused around the idea of social connection and museums being a place where you can meet other individuals who are like-minded, have similar interests, particularly for older adults no longer in the workforce who may no longer feel that same sense of community as they did when they were employed and are at heightened risk for social isolation. Specific programs have been developed for older adults to help mitigate against this social isolation and have had a great deal of success in decreasing that social disconnect and helping them feel a greater sense of community. But art museums just don't pop out of the ground. These are institutions that are carefully curated, that the experience is designed very carefully for us. And that's done very much under the care of art museum professionals working in a variety of capacities to help give us a good experience when we do walk into the doors at the art museum. And one of the things that I noticed in seeing what had already been done in this area is that no one's been asking the art museum professionals, well, is well-being an important thing that you really want to focus on as an institution? Or is it just like a nice side benefit that people, it's nice people flourish in the museum, but we're not going to focus our attention there. It's not important to us as an institutional goal. And so to follow up on this review, I asked some of those questions in a national sample of about 200 art museum professionals who worked across a number of departments in art museums, from the curators, the educators, the front of house staff who are giving you your tickets, the security personnel, the restoration experts and researchers. And what we wanted to know was, what do art museums professionals believe the aims are of art museums? Like, what are the goals currently? And what do they think the goals should be? And where does well-being rank as one of these aims? Is it important? Is it whatever? Is it like, that's not our lane. We don't care about trying to promote that, but if you will get it, cool. And finally, if we ask about specific aspects of well-being and ill-being, are there particular ones that art museum professionals agree that the art museum can do a really nice job in cultivating for their visitors? And so just to orient you to this figure, this is our findings about the general aims of art museums. So we asked people to rate what are the current aims of the museum and what should ideally be the aims of the museum? And this is representing the difference between those two. So bars on the left indicate aims for which the art museum professionals felt they should be more highly prioritized than they currently are. And so of all of these, the highest one was well-being. So of all of the aims, art museum professionals felt this is the one that needs the greatest further prioritization than what's currently happening. And if we look at some of the ones that are right behind it, they also are aligned. So being a place for the community, helping to support artists, being a place for social interaction, help people change their perspectives or reflect on their worldview, providing opportunities for cultural engagement and education. And so it seems as though this broader idea of flourishing is on the minds of art museum professionals. And when we asked about specific well-being and ill-being factors, they indicated that they feel that art museums are well equipped to try to address things like empathy, reducing closed-mindedness, helping people feel greater self-acceptance and less self-doubt, and helping to decrease that social disconnect. And so these are things that the psychologists hadn't been focusing on. We hadn't been studying empathy or self-acceptance necessarily in the art museum context. We've been focusing largely on people's emotion or their social connection, which is in partial alignment with what the art museum professional said. But this really points out there are other things that art museums might be doing well that we should take note of. And so in light of this, what can we do as researchers? And this was kind of the question I asked myself, like, what can I do as a researcher to help better understand flourishing at art museums? And how can we best support art museums with resources, research, and knowledge to better capitalize on some of those areas for improvement that they identified? And so this past summer, we collaborated with three art museums in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the Carnegie Museum of Art, the Andy Warhol Museum, and the Westmoreland Museum of American Art, to do a broad survey of flourishing in their art museum of their visitors. And so we focus on five different domains of flourishing. And so psychological distress is that kind of mental health piece, so feelings of anxiety or stress. And so we focused on this because it was something the literature had already focused on quite extensively. We thought about empathy, positive self-regard, social connection and meaning as things that the art museum professionals identified as being really important in their institutions, but that, with the exception of social connection, hadn't really been studied in any systematic or widespread manner. And in addition to measuring these five domains of flourishing, we also assess people's emotional experience. So what sort of positive emotions were they experiencing? What negative emotions were they experiencing? Were they entering into so-called aesthetic states like awe or feeling moved or getting goosebumps and chills? And did they feel confused by the art? Were they really interested in the art? Were there things that were surprising to them? And so to make sense of all of this information, we wanted to know what were the connections between people's emotional experiences and what their flourishing looked like. And so what we did is we grouped people using latent class analysis, for anyone who's interested in the analytics side of this, to understand what sorts of profiles do we get from people's emotional experiences. So this was a sample of about 600 museum visitors. And what we saw is that people's emotional experiences tended to follow one of three patterns. The first pattern in kind of this orange right here was really characterized by people's negative emotions. So they had heightened levels of negative emotion in their experience, a little bit lower levels of positive emotion, and they felt a bit confused during their experience. This was about a quarter of visitors. About 60% of visitors had emotional experiences really characterized by positive emotions. So they had heightened positive emotion, quite low negative emotion, and felt a decent amount of awe, wonder, and chills, and were not particularly confused by their visit. And then there was a small portion of people who were just really irritated during their visit. Maybe they were dragged along, maybe something in the art upset them or offended them in some way, but they had very high levels of negative emotion and felt very confused during their experience. And what we want to know is, based on the types of emotions that you're experiencing, does that have impact or influence on what sort of flourishing outcomes that you experience? And so if we again look at these three different groups of visitors and those five different flourishing outcomes, what we see is that the positive group in green here had very low levels of psychological distress compared to people who whose visit was characterized by feeling negative emotions. And those who experienced that heightened positive emotion, so in green, felt greater positive self-regard, so greater self-acceptance, self-compassion, self-efficacy. They felt more socially connected to others in the museum, and they felt no differences in meaning or empathy. So all three of the groups had similar high levels of empathy and high levels of meaning. But something else that was really remarkable to us is that regardless of people's emotional experiences, they were still flourishing pretty well, where it was really just in psychological distress. So feeling that stress and that anxiety was the only spot where the negative emotions seemed to take over experience. But on a 5-point scale, people were averaging quite high levels of well-being. So that was really interesting because no one had measured some of these areas of well-being previously. But even though we can focus on the art museum experience itself, there have been radical shifts in how we engage with visual art. So when I was growing up, if I thought about, I want to engage with visual art, I was like, we're going to the museum. And that's probably how many of you often think about engaging with visual art. And then a little thing called the COVID-19 pandemic changed that quite radically because museums had to close their doors, but they didn't close the art off from people. So they did some fabulous pivoting to make virtual offerings available to provide tours of their collections, to put their collections online, to have educational workshops online. And so now we can still go to the art museum, but there are very rich digital engagement opportunities that exist. And so some of these innovations are things like Google Arts and Culture, which has a massive amount of art and cultural artifacts available for you to search, to explore really interesting historical information. You can do really close looking and zoom in to see the brushstrokes right on your screen for artwork that might be 7 countries away that you might never see in person. But also individual institutions such as the National Gallery created these nice virtual tours where you can simulate walking around one of their galleries and observe their art. And there are a lot of benefits to this type of engagement. There's greater accessibility in a number of ways. So if you're not able to navigate art museums easily for whatever reason, don't like being in such public spaces or still are not comfortable going into public spaces, you can still access the art. These virtual art engagement opportunities are free or low cost oftentimes, so any financial barriers are often removed. There's a broader geographic reach because I can look at things in the Louvre and I can look at things out in Pittsburgh in the same day and take in a broad swath of art. And there's more flexibility in the nature of our engagement. We can come back to it multiple times if we want to. It's not limited by when the museum happens to be open. So we can do it at midnight if we want a little dose of art at midnight, a little midnight art snack, if you will. So there's a lot of accessibility advantages, a lot of flexibility advantages to this type of virtual art engagement, particularly some of these more curated virtual art engagement versus just Googling an artwork and seeing what pops up for you. But there's not a whole lot of research going into this. So what actually happens during virtual art engagement, particularly in these more intentionally crafted ways? And so more recently, this is what I've been focusing on and really just understanding what are some of the basic things that happen when we engage in art in these sort of like virtual gallery ways. So first, can it actually impact our emotions? We know that going to the museum in person can have a wide-ranging impact on our emotions. We can feel awe, we can feel moved, we can get the goosebumps, we can feel transformed in front of a masterpiece. Can we have any of that even on a lower level, virtually? And are there any flourishing benefits to this type of engagement? So again, there's been a host of research examining what happens in person in the gallery, but do some of those benefits extend into a virtual space? And so to conduct this research, I've been using the Open Gallery for Arts Research, which is a fabulous platform developed by Rebecca Rodriguez-Borwinkle and Martin Borwinkle. And you can basically curate your own gallery and track everything people are doing in there. So from a research standpoint, it's really nice. I could recreate someone's virtual gallery experience based on the information this collects. And so we can put whatever art in there that we want. We can design the floor plan any way we want. We can change the colors of the walls and add labels and not have labels. So there's a lot of freedom in how you can curate it. And it's been a really, really powerful tool in helping us understand what may happen when we engage with art in these types of virtual gallery ways. And so in just an initial project of this, we created a small two-room gallery with 8 artworks and let people loose in it for 15 minutes and asked them before and after what their current emotional state was. And so we asked about a range of positive, negative, and kind of aesthetic states. And we also asked them to complete before and after some measures about their flourishing. So overall thriving, as well as some factors related to psychological well-being, like self-acceptance, feeling personal growth, sense of purpose, and so forth. And then we just saw, did the gallery change any of this? Did we increase certain emotions? Did we decrease certain emotions through this type of very, very brief virtual gallery visit? And what we saw was that for positive emotion, there weren't a ton of changes. And so people felt less energetic after coming out of the gallery, but felt more relaxed. So we kind of calmed down people's like activation or energy levels a little bit. So art had a little bit of a calming effect perhaps. But where we saw the most change or a more widespread change was with negative emotion. So people felt less angry, less irritable, less anxious and tense in particular, as well as less unhappy following their brief dose of virtual visual art. But particularly interestingly, people still felt a sense of awe, moved, and chills in there, which is quite interesting if you think about having some of these more like heightened aesthetic experiences in this more artificial environment where you're looking at a relatively small on your computer screen work of art. So I found that particularly exciting because it maybe means here's a really easy way to give people a dose of art in their lives and potentially impact their emotions. And further, we also saw changes in people's flourishing. So people increased their overall thriving. They felt more satisfaction with their life, greater self-acceptance, as well as greater personal growth. We didn't see change in a few things like their satisfaction with their relationships, their sense of autonomy, or their mastery of their environment, or how competent they feel. But we also didn't harm any of their areas of flourishing, which is always something that you want to make sure you're not doing. So we did see a few increases. So it gives us some good initial evidence that virtual art experiences may be one tool in our pocket in helping people thrive and flourish through the arts, particularly visual art. And so that's a small taste of some of the research, but now it's like, well, what do we do next? Where do we go from here? What should we be focusing on? What should we be curious about? And so hopefully I've provided you at least with some initial evidence, initial thoughts around the connection between art engagement benefiting flourishing. But something that's really an open question is, well, why does this happen? Like, what's the active ingredient that our arts engagement can have that helps us to flourish? And so a recent model from that positive humanities field that I mentioned at the beginning, which is, again, this new field concerned with how arts and culture can help us to flourish, both from a more practice-oriented lens as well as a more empirical research lens. They have proposed the RAISE mechanism model that identifies five different areas or five different active ingredients about the nature of our art engagement that may help to explain how we go from engaging with the arts to flourishing. And so just very briefly, when we are kind of more reflective during our art engagement, so these are intentional processes that we engage in, cognitive processes or emotional processes that help us to develop, reinforce, or discard some of our values, our worldview, so help us change our perspective or consider or reconsider our perspective. We may be more likely to flourish if we engage in some of these more reflective processes. If we engage in acquisition, which is processes that underlie the development of our perspectives, habits, or skills, so things that help us to feel greater self-efficacy or to feel greater self-esteem, what's happening? What are we doing? Are we practicing in order to gain those skills, for example? Immersion, which is seen as kind of the gateway. And this is really about our attention being captured in us, really being present in the moment, is deeply connected to people's flow experiences as proposed by Csikszentmihalyi. But basically our attention is captured, resulting in experiencing various levels of sensory and emotional states and cognitions, leading to feelings of being carried away and disconnected from our everyday life. We may lose track of time as part of this. And so it's hard to imagine how you can flourish if you're just glancing at artworks and moving along with your lives, but taking the time to stop and slow down and actually spend time with the art and think about it. Is how immersion is theorized to be connected. Our socialization during artwork. So the degree to which we take on roles or identities. So if we identify as an art lover and feel that's a core part of ourselves, we may flourish more during those art experiences. If we share those experiences with others to help reaffirm that identity, we may flourish additionally during that artistic experience. And finally, expression, which I think a little bit goes without saying that the arts can be a way to express yourself. And so externalizing your thoughts and feelings that you may share with others, but you may also just do for yourself. So creating an artwork, whether it's something you're submitting to be displayed in a museum or in a gallery, or if you're just doodling for yourself and it's just that outlet of your expression. And so this model has been proposed, and we're currently doing a whole bunch of research kind of testing out this model. But when you think about how you engage with the arts, you can think about, well, what am I doing during that engagement that may help our flourishing? And so these are potential targets. So how can we design programs or art engagement opportunities for people to help them get into an immersed state or to help them socialize or express themselves? And so this model is posited really to be some of those active ingredients that help us go from just seeing some art to being transformed by that art. And I think the other really, really important piece in the future of this work, in the future of arts and health and flourishing, is ensuring that there's deep collaborations between practitioners in the arts and cultural institutions and researchers to develop different initiatives to understand what's happening. And so the first step of this is evidence-informed practice. So there is a bunch of research out there currently, and I think some researchers are better at it. I'm trying to be better at it, of getting the word out to people who may be interested. And so this is one way of doing that. So that we can think about, well, we see that art museums are really good at helping people feel more connected with one another. Maybe let's try developing some programs that draw on that research to really amp up those effects or broaden those effects so that more people are benefiting from that engagement. But then on the flip side, we need practice-informed research. So it's all nice for me to do my theoretical research that has no ties in reality. It's not going to be useful to art professionals. And so having collaborators working in the field that know what it means to develop an art museum program and how what's going to work for from a delivery standpoint and how to engage visitors is super important so that we are assessing and measuring things that are relevant. And when you put both of those things together, that evidence-informed practice and that practice-informed research, we really come to program assessment. So as these new initiatives or programs or visit nudges are developed, we need to understand what are the impacts of them? Are they having the intended impacts? Are they increasing feelings of social connection? Are they helping people flourish? And if they are, great, let's get the word out and try to spread it to new audiences and to spread it to different institutions or different artistic domains to really capitalize on the power of the arts. But if it's not working, let's revisit and hone it so that we're hopefully getting the intended outcome for the visitors. And so I'll end there. I know I ran a little quicker than our time, but I always love leaving ample time to have questions because I know people always have great connections to this material. And so, again, thank you to all of you for coming to this session and to listening. And of course, need to thank the various agencies and sponsors and funders of this work, as well as my collaborators. If you're curious about some of the work that I presented here or just the broader work of the positive humanities, I encourage you to go to our research lab website, www.humanitiesandhumanflourishing.org, to learn more. We have a newsletter, we have colloquium series. So if you want to be kept in the loop with this field in general, that's really the best spot to do that. So thank you all again. I'll stop that sharing.
Thanks so much, Dr. Cotter. That was so interesting. I'm sure there are some questions that we can post here. Anyone have a question, please use the raise hand function or type in the chat box.
Well, maybe I'll ask one, Katherine. Could you speak to the distinctions that you see in terms of the emotional responsiveness, the emotional response and flourishing, the effects on flourishing by comparing an online museum to really going in person, where it's much more well embodied, I suppose, and you're walking around and you're getting a sense of, you know, you can examine the work so differently. Is there anyone doing work that speaks to that issue?
So people are starting to do some of this work now that there's better research tools to better mirror of an in-person visit. So a lot of the prior kind of online or virtual experiences have been, here, I'm just going to plop an image on your computer screen and look, which takes away some of the some of the important elements, I think, that are present in a art museum context, like choice. You can explore and choose to look how long you want at certain images and navigate and ignore certain ones if you don't want to look at it. And so something that I'm hoping to do, I know Rebecca, who is the mastermind largely behind this work with the virtual gallery, in trying to replicate an actual gallery space in the virtual environment and just seeing what difference do we have in an experimental context for a number of outcomes, like their satisfaction and so forth. I know from kind of anecdotal feedback that we got through this research, a lot of people were like, oh, I couldn't see the brush strokes, or I didn't get a sense of the texture because it's a two-dimensional image, or didn't get a sense of the scale or of how big or small the artwork is. But we also had a lot of people say, like, I haven't been able to do an art gallery in so long. Thank you for having this as a tool or an option. So I think there's benefits and probably not as much emotional power behind it, but we still have some power behind it.
No, I think it's really powerful to show that there's so much that can come from the online context. It's just, I see it as quite different, and
yes,
because you have other people around you typically, and you're sharing that space, and you're drawn to what someone else is looking at, or, you know, there's a lot of dynamism in real life context.
And I've seen a few virtual gallery tours that different platforms have put together, and some of them actually have a social piece to it where you can like see avatars for other people. In our work, it has just been like independent alone viewing, but we're trying to figure out a good way to try to mirror some of that social aspect, because it is really important. You have really interesting conversations with strangers or the docents in an art museum that you're not going to get necessarily in the same way online.
Thank you.
We have a question from Sarah in the chat about whether you have any plans to extend this research into other fields. I would also be interested in knowing that. Theater, dance, engagement, and flourishing. Yeah.
Yeah. So we are currently like on the cusp of launching two different branches of research. One is within music. So since based on that kind of representative sample survey that we did, the two biggest categories of engagement were visual art and music. And so we're trying to start with the two kind of most frequently engaged art forms. And so we're getting ready to launch a new research initiative into music and flourishing that I'll be involved in. And then we also we joined in October, Krista Malobo as a new postdoc in the lab. And she is concerned with, she's a developmental psychologist focusing on flourishing for Black youth. And so we're looking at artistic traditions that are not studied typically in research. So things like hip hop and jazz and rap music, and how that can help Black individuals in particular flourish. And so she's currently developing and about to launch some of that to look at it across art forms, but that have perhaps more cultural salience to a particular population as well. So yes, and we do have aspirations to further branch out into other art forms and so forth as our team expands and additional funders are interested, of course.
Indeed. Thank you. That's so interesting.
Can I ask another question while we're waiting for more? I'm wondering if you can speak to the differences in the emotions you saw, because you didn't, it's just the kind of emotions that you saw, well, increase, whatever you'd like to call it, was all, and this kind of aesthetic, what we refer to as aesthetic emotions, as opposed to the sort of positive and negative. And I'm wondering if you can speak to what it is about this kind of engagement that deeply engages this meaning-making function of the way we approach the world. And I wonder if you'd go so far as to say, you know, this is already important stuff, and so maybe we should be advocating for pushing for, you know, this to be part of, I don't know, curriculum stuff. You have, you know, I'm wondering what your thoughts are, because so much of what I like about the stuff that you do is you really focus on these complex emotions that are really quite understudied, because the emotional field of emotion, as you know, is always a little bit focusing on the more, I don't want to call them basic emotions, but less about the aesthetic levels. And so I'm wondering what your thoughts are.
Yeah, so one piece that I didn't get into in this presentation is in that same project, we also were examining how immersed people felt in the gallery, because we were just curious, like, can people feel any sense of immersion? And they could. And so what we saw that was that those changes in emotions were also considerably a function of how immersed they were in the experience. And so people who are more immersed, we actually did see a lot of more change in those positive emotions, as well as reductions in those negative emotions that just in a simple pre-post difference we're not seeing. Similarly with the flourishing outcomes, a lot of it seemed to be a function of immersion. But interestingly, not a function of people's interest in art, which I think is quite important, because particularly with visual art, because I know whenever I present this work, some folks are like, I'm not an art person. I don't know how to look at art. I have no clue what I'm doing in a museum. And it seems as though there isn't necessarily an association between getting these benefits and having a deep interest in visual art. And so I think with that result in particular, I think this is quite important. I'm always the everyone should have all of the art all of the time type of person personally. Whatever style, whatever genre, whatever domain really resonates with you. So I do think that there are some interesting curricular opportunities. Something that I'm working on a collaboration with is the medical humanities. So working with medical students and residents, and I was actually able to observe a program hosted by an art museum recently. And basically these are first year residents, they're in their intern year figuring out what it means to be a doctor in a more professional sense. And they came and spent half a day at the Philadelphia Museum of Art doing close looking, where they literally spent an hour looking at a single artwork and dissecting what they were seeing. And then it was really interesting because for the first 5 minutes, they're all sitting there like, what are we doing? We're doctors. Why are we doing this? Some of the more art inclined were like jumping in and really enthusiastic. But after about 10 minutes, everyone's saying, no, that's not a hand. That's a baby or something about what they're seeing. And then throughout the day, it got more deeper and personal. So by the end of it, they were exploring the contemporary abstract art area of the museum and picking out artworks that represented their training experience and telling these really beautiful stories about how they're connecting to caregiving and making it more humanistic versus checking off a list of symptoms. So I do think there are these broader applications that are not just how I personally feel at this moment, but if we help doctors through the arts to be more humanistic in their practice, there's downstream flourishing benefits for all of their patients in the future, potentially as well.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned doctors and that got me thinking about, oh, I just asked this quick question and maybe I'll ask the last one. Becca,
I see Harrison has a question about art engagement. As art engagement supports human flourishing, what you see as barriers, if so, to art engagement? If so, would you view access to art and art engagement as a moral concern as it connects with flourishing?
Yeah, so there's different types of barriers. I think I'll like broadly kind of categorize them into more like resource barriers. So some people may not necessarily have the time to go to a museum, a concert, what have you, might not have financial means to visit these cultural institutions. Then I think there's also interesting cultural barriers. I think one in particular that we've seen is that it's really important from again, art museums, but I'm sure likely applies in other contexts as well, but it's really important to feel that your identity is represented in what you're seeing, whether that's in what's being depicted, it being from a cultural tradition that you identify with, whether the artist shares an identity with you, even if the depiction isn't necessarily resonant with your identity. We see that particularly for that self-acceptance, that positive self-regard piece, that's really important for that aspect of flourishing, to have that identity piece. And so if we think about, and I'll speak primarily from like a US perspective, but I think applies in other contexts as well. If we think about art museums or other cultural institutions, historically, they've been for the white, largely been for the well-educated, for the wealthy, from particular kind of cultural sects. And if you don't feel represented in those contexts, why are you going to go? And so I think from there's kind of like that standpoint of potential barriers that I think the cultural sector is grappling with and trying to address by diversifying their collections and being more welcoming. But I also think there's other really basic features for anybody. Like, I don't know what to do when I go to an art museum. I don't know what the norms are. Do you dress up to go to the art museum? Do you have to be silent the whole time? Like, I'm looking at it. I don't know what I'm supposed to be looking at or focusing. So I think there's also some of those pieces that people aren't comfortable in, that like uncertainty. And so may therefore not engage necessarily with art museums in particular. So I think, Yeah, so there's a few different ways where people are maybe not accessing at the level that they could to benefit their flourishing, but I also think they're likely engaging in other ways. I think it would be really hard to imagine someone who is completely devoid of artistic engagement, but I do think certain types of engagement are less well represented in certain areas of the population than others, and some are particularly understudied. So for example, like with Chris's work that she's doing on Black Americans and their cultural engagement, a lot of the things that we're going to be looking at in her work are not things that psychology has typically been focusing on. And so I think there's a few disconnects from an empirical standpoint that we just don't know about because it hasn't been studied at a high level.
Speaking of immersion, as you have, there's a comment from Maria here in the chat about the Monet immersion experience and the immersive art experiences, and including virtual reality. So I wonder what you're thinking, and certainly Maria, add to this question. It was more of a comment, but you know, I think it could be worth discussing about this immersive type experience.
And I think those experiences also are engaging a different audience than a traditional Monet exhibit would, which I think is really important. And they seem to be popping up like everywhere. There's the Van Gogh one, there's the Monet ones, there's, I don't even know which other ones at this point. And so I'm really interested to start doing research on that and seeing who's coming to it and what are they getting out of it? And is it different than if we sent them into a Monet room at a traditional art gallery or in the virtual gallery? Something that we are interested in exploring in probably a few years of doing is the virtual gallery that I briefly showed, trying to adapt it to work with VR. Because I think sometimes like the computer navigation is not as like smooth as you would necessarily like. But I think VR is particularly interesting since there have been a number of, particularly in the more like physical health domain and some mental health domain, using like VR applications as treatments that have seen benefits for individuals. So I'm curious if we can have like a virtual reality artistic treatment, or have like an app that people can plug into their headsets and whatnot. So I think technology, as it's increasing, and I guess there's like the AI talk earlier, and I guess she didn't finish the slides until right before, because who knows what the new change is going to be with AI changing every day. So I think as technology continues to evolve in these ways, there's going to be some really exciting directions that we can think about artistic engagement that isn't I go to the art museum and see the original work, but maybe I experience it in a new or different way that gives me a new perspective or a new thought or different flourishing outcome than if I see the original.
There's another Anna. Would you like to ask this question from the chat, or
since you only if there is no other there? Okay. Give me 1 second. All right, then I'll hog the time as well. Katherine, I know you must get this question a lot. I'd really love to know your take on this. How does your work on the association between arts and flourishing fit with the extensive work on the association between the arts and mental illness? So would you see this as a contradiction between bodies of research that is yet to be resolved? Or are the two bodies of research talking about different things?
Yeah, so I'll say most of the work that I've focused on has been in the area of more like receptive arts engagement. So viewing art, listening to music versus creating art or music, which is where we typically see the connection between the arts and illness, or creativity and illness. And if we talk about creativity and illness more broadly, Selchuk Akar has like fabulous meta-analyses out there on this topic. And something that kind of he's observed and other scholars have observed around creativity more generally is that for like the day-to-day creativity that we're engaged in, so like the tweaking my chili recipe with some new spices type of thing versus I'm trying to be a revolutionary creator in the arts or so forth, those lower levels or more day-to-day everyday creativity is associated with flourishing. But where the potential for that association between creativity or creative arts and mental illness is seen more as in the professional level potentially. And I think there's a few different reasons for that. I mean, there's the huge trope that the creative genius is mad and so on and so forth. And there's obviously very easy examples that we can call up that speak to that. But I think if we think about, for example, professional musicians, you would think, they're doing music all day, every day. They must have the best lives ever and be flourishing in all these levels. But if you think about the professionalization of some of these fields, then a lot of the elements that you get from like a receptive engagement standpoint or just a hobbyist standpoint are taken away. You don't get to choose what you're playing if you're in an orchestra. You don't get to choose when you're playing it or how you're playing it. So you lose a lot of that autonomy and that choice and some of that freedom of expression, which is one of those mechanisms I was talking about. So I think, and so if you look at the well-being of that population, perhaps it would look maybe quite lower than you would expect. I would imagine, because there's some of these elements that are missing. So I think the trope tends to be that you are an artist, you're going to suffer, you have to suffer for your art. But I don't think it's necessarily directional in that particular way. I think there's some other factors that in the professionalization of what it means to be a professional artist kind of chip away at some of the benefits that you may get in some contexts.
We have time for one or two, maybe more questions. We have about 4 minutes left. I do have a question if I don't see anything else at the moment. Back to the idea of barriers thinking about art museums as a place of flourishing, but the art museum is so centralized, you'd mentioned that in barriers. So this might be tangential to your specific topic, but in this thread, what efforts have you noticed about decentralizing art museum experiences in the spirit of choice or in the spirit of barriers, to decentralize this place we all go, pay this money, see these art on this wall, very specific experience?
So something that I think is not necessarily acknowledged enough, but is really important is the role of more community museums or community galleries, which tend to be smaller, have smaller collections, but you can still get really great stuff out of them. So I've done studies with when I was in graduate school in North Carolina, doing studies with the University Art Museum, which had, I think, 4 or 5 gallery spaces. So you could see everything in a relatively meaningful way in about an hour or so, hour and a half, depending on how long you stop. And people got a lot out of their experiences, came away with it saying that it was really interesting, had really interesting emotional changes as part of it, and really enjoyed their experience. So I think it's still centralized in some way, but I think when we think of the museum, we think of the major like landmark type of museums that have like the classics or the masterpieces everyone has heard about and flocks to and takes a selfie with and so on. But I think a smaller and more hidden gem are some of these more community spaces that in your library, there might be artworks that are on display that you can go have an aesthetic experience with that isn't necessarily in a museum, in a school. There certainly are going to be some of these. In like a public government building, there's often art on the walls that is not just the kind of like hotel art that's just like a weird little print that they stick up there to make it look nice for you or feel a little homey. So I think if we broaden what we mean by art museum or consider like a visual art experience, I think we can think about access in a little bit of a different way. Certainly there's still many steps to go, but I think that's one way of thinking about access slightly differently.
And I'll squeeze this last question in that just came in about talking about the mental health interventions and medical students. Have you seen any, and Harrison, hope I'm getting this accurately, has your team worked with clinical therapists you work with medical students? Have you worked with clinical therapists or in clinical settings? Thank you.
Yeah, so presently we have not been working in clinical settings, and we're working with some of those medical humanities programs to do more large-scale assessment of like what's happening for the residents and do those changes actually happen. And so we have not yet worked in clinical spaces specifically. So I will say our work has tended to focus more on the well-being side of flourishing rather than the ill-being side, just given that we're in a positive psychology center. And in clinical spaces, the emphasis traditionally tends to be on ill-being, though that's not exclusively the case, certainly. So I will say we haven't done it yet, but I think there's certainly a role for that. And there's fabulous creative arts therapists that are doing a lot of that work in those settings in particular.
Thank you for responding to that last final quick question. And that is our time for today. Thank you so much, Dr. Katherine Cotter. And thank you for everyone for being here. We appreciate this lovely engaging talk as part of the Festival Ideas. Anna, did you have anything
concluding? No, thank you all so much for being here. We'll start the next session right away. So I hope to see many of you there. All right. Bye-bye. Thank you so much, Katherine.